Hi, I'm Ron Stern. We're the road crew from Sting in Porto Alegre, Brazil.
Good morning, America!
And in a few minutes, we will be hearing from Sting himself. Jeff Greenfield recently talked with him in Brazil, where he's preparing for his concert on behalf of Amnesty International. Good morning, everyone. I'm Joan London in New York.
And I'm Charles Gibson. Joan, that certainly didn't sound like the normal theme music, did it?
No, it didn't.
I'm down in Washington, of course, for the summit. Today is Thursday, December 10th. And
39 After. Music has always been used to motivate and move people. Our political media editor, Jeff Greenfield, recently went backstage to meet one of this generation's prime movers in this field. Good morning, Jeff.
A lot more fun than Iowa. You know, in recent years, some of the most celebrated figures in rock music have been using its appeal to raise money and public interest in causes that have ranged from world hunger to human rights. No one's been more consistent in this work than Sting, former lead singer of The Police, now one of pop music's most celebrated and successful solo artists. We got a chance last week in Brazil to see and hear from Sting on stage and backstage, and it began with what could have been a full-scale disaster. A few hours from now, some 80,000 fans will pack the Stadio Olimpico in Porto Alegre to hear Sting and his band perform. And so far, nothing has gone right. The gear arrived hours late. The Brazilian crew does not know how to put the massive stage together. The military and local security have decided to keep the fans far from the stage. And in his dressing room, Sting is nursing a badly injured shoulder that has rendered his left arm all but immobilized. Sting's fans poured into the vast arena for the best vantage points. But as the hours dragged on, the weather turned ugly. Rain and wind threatened everything from permanent equipment damage to electrocution. Sting's managers nearly decide to have the star himself announce a postponement.
Sorry, power problems. I'm going to save one song for you, and I'm going to come back and do the show tomorrow night.
But that, warned local promoters, could cause a full-scale riot. Providentially, the skies clear at that moment. The band moves on stage. And it begins. Sting is at the apex of stardom because his music and his presence has the power to make and to move millions. To arouse them, to seduce them.
While the soldiers here, their faces fixed like stone, can't see what it is that they despise.
But Sting's music also has another kind of power. Watch this audience as he sings They Dance Alone, about the women of Chile who dance with pictures of their loved ones who have vanished into the prisons and graves of the Pinochet dictatorship.
Universal thing that everybody can understand, a mother's love for a son or a wife's love for her husband. It's not just saying, you know, Pinochet is a, you know, a bad dictator. I mean, that's has no artistic value whatever, but to couch that in a metaphor is, I think, is worth doing. I mean, I'm not interested in cars or girlfriends or dancing particularly, but I am interested in what's happening to the world. And if I'm not allowed to sing about the things that interest me, then I'm in the wrong job.
Sting's involvement in causes beyond the box office is no one-time fad. He's performed at the Prince's Trust concerts in England. He was part of the 1986 Live Aid Transcontinental concerts to fight starvation in Africa. But most of his energy goes toward Amnesty International, the worldwide movement that supports prisoners of conscience and victims of torture around the world.
Having met some of the people who've been freed by Amnesty, that was the most profound thing that happened on the tour, not playing to thousands of people on live television, but just meeting these people who'd been really cruelly treated.
At these Amnesty concerts, you get thousands and thousands of people who come, they have a good time, they may be drinking beer, they're frolicking, and then comes the political message. Is it difficult to mesh those two?
When we do a concert for Amnesty, the issues are very heavy. But, you know, you're bringing kids in, they're having a great time, they're drinking beer, and there's great music happening, and then you say, well, think about this. And if, you know, 1 out of 100 is convinced, and 1 over, then I think that's good. If Matt Leland people just have a good time, that's okay too.
Tomorrow, among other things, we're going to ask Sting whether or not he'd like to follow our actor-turned-politician and get into the political arena on his own. Joan?
Very interesting. Thank you, Jeff. See you tomorrow.
Yes, ma'am.
It is December the 11th, and coming up this morning, we will hear from one of the most influential performers in the world, rock star Sting, who takes his message as seriously as he takes his music. Sting on the record right after this from Revlon. It is now 38 after recently Jeff Greenfield was able to spend some time with Sting on tour in South America. He's back with us this morning with more of his interview. Good morning to you.
Good morning. Yesterday we showed you the rock superstar Sting during his concert tour in Brazil, performing the music that's made him a worldwide celebrity and talking about his interest in the human rights issue, an interest that'll take him around the world next summer as part of a rock concert tour on behalf of Amnesty International. The songs that Sting writes and sings often share a common trait. The verses are complicated melodically and lyrically. They paint vivid word pictures. They challenge the audience. But the choruses hold a payoff. Full tilt, all out rock and roll. Sting's political involvement has that same mix. The music is the payoff, drawing the crowds and the publicity for a cause like human rights. But does that combination trivialize so grave an issue as torture and repression?
I've heard it before. I think pop performers as a breed need to be very careful about how they approach these. I think we have to have a certain dignity. I don't think we should be, you know, singing about human rights or anything else and being looking silly. You know, I'm a grown man, and I have, if life is a roulette table, I have this little chip, and however bashed and bruised it is, I want to stick it on the table and say, this is what I bet on. I'm not going to be put in a box.
On stage, Sting gives his audience the raw, youthful energy that has always been at the heart of rock and roll's appeal. But as a 36-year-old father of four, Sting has found his attention drawn by wider concerns.
The sort of rock and roll attitude, the standard attitude, is you know, die young, don't care, live fast, have a beautiful corpse. As soon as you have children, the whole perspective is changed. You start thinking about their futures, where they're going to go, what kind of people they're going to live with, what kind of world is it, can they breathe the air, will they have jobs, are they safe on the street?
Do you have a what-if fantasy? Do you have a dream of where this ultimately leads? What I mean is, do you ever have the notion that a P.W. Botha or a Kim Il-sung or a Pinochet is going to see the work of Amnesty and say, I've been just going the wrong way, let's open these prisons?
I don't think any of those people have listened to my record, have ever heard of me, or care about me. But the three people you've mentioned crave the support of countries where I am accepted. I'm not going to topple Pinochet or anything else. I have no illusions about that. But I think, you know, if someone outside says something for people who are trapped in a situation, that gives them a feeling of support.
The United States has a president who's an ex-actor, a candidate who's an ex-football player, a potential president who's an ex-basketball star. Why not a milkman's son turned singer as a political figure?
Sure. I'm very wary of politics because I feel that every politician will eventually face a choice between his ethics and political expediency. And sooner or later, along the path of success in that world, you're going to have to make a decision that is unethical or immoral even, because you need to reach the next gate. I don't belong to a political party or a church or any kind of organization, really, because I already have a forum. I don't need people to speak for me. With the media, it's becoming increasingly important for a man to be a good communicator. It's always been the case, but even more so now. I think you have to take it seriously that professional entertainers have a place in the arena, not necessarily as politicians, but certainly people with a voice. Every breath you take, every move you make, every bond you break, every step you take, I'll be watching you.
One consequence of Sting's involvement in causes, he says, is that some of his best-known songs now mean something very different to him, like the smash hit Every Breath You Take.
Oh, that's a very evil song. I mean, it was the biggest hit of 1984, which is another irony. It's a Big Brother anthem, and I think it's totally wicked. There is a seductive power about surveillance. You know, it's the need to be protected and watched all the time. You know, I think it's the springboard for people like Jerry Falwell, certainly Reagan.
Skeptics ought to note that after last spring's Amnesty tour, 40,000 people signed up as permanent letter writers for Amnesty, joining the group as part of a permanent human rights constituency. So it does seem to work.
It's really been fascinating. I didn't know any of these things about Sting. Thank you.
Every stereotype you have of a rock singer goes away when you talk to him.
You
fascinating
bet.
Guy.
Interesting. Thanks, Jeff.